Good morning. Happy Bastille Day. Madam Secretary, would you please announce our agenda?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning to you and good morning, Commissioners. For today's meeting, you will hear two items for your consideration. First, you will consider a report and order and further notice of proposed rulemaking that would make spectrum in bands above 24 gigahertz available for flexible use wireless services, including for next generation or 5G networks and technologies. Second, you will consider a declaratory ruling, second report and order, and order on reconsideration that adopts a framework to guide transitions to next generation communication technologies while protecting the interests of consumers and competition. Please note the consent agenda item, as listed in the Commission's July 2016 Sunshine Notice, has been adopted by the Commission and is deleted from today's agenda. This is your agenda for today. The first item will be presented by the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau and the Office of Engineering and Technology, and it is entitled Use of Spectrum Bands Above 24 Gigahertz for Mobile Radio Services. And John Wilkins, Chief of the Bureau, will give the introduction.
Thank you, Mr. Wilkins.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Welcome. Is this your rookie appearance? This it? No?
3.5 a little while ago.
Oh,
so.
Sorry.
Not my first rodeo, sir. It's my pleasure to introduce the Spectrum Frontiers Report and Order and further notice of proposed rulemaking. This item establishes a flexible regulatory and technical framework to make four spectrum bands above 24 gigahertz available for mobile broadband and other uses. It also seeks comment on making an even greater number of additional bands available using the same flexible framework. The world is pushing forward to the next generation of wireless connectivity, generally referred to as 5G. The item before the Commission today establishes our leadership position in this transition by continuing in the tradition of innovative spectrum policy that has supported the tremendous success of wireless services in the United States. Through this action, the Commission will put flexible rules in place for millimeter wave spectrum that will foster a market environment in which innovation and new technologies can flourish. I'm joined at the table by Julie Knapp, Chief of OET, Mindell De La Torre, Chief of the International Bureau, and then from the Wireless Bureau, Catherine Schrader, Brian Regan, and John Schauble. Michael Ha from OET, and Jose Albuquerque from IB. It's been a true team effort across a lot of the bureaus of the Commission. And in addition to the team here, I also want to thank the staff from the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau, the Enforcement Bureau, Office of General Counsel, and the very large number of other folks in all the bureaus and offices for their really tireless work on this item. And then Catherine will present the item.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. This report and order on FNPRM establishes service rules for frequency bands above 24 gigahertz for mobile and other uses, and proposes additional bands for further consideration. Specifically, it adopts licensed service rules for three bands, 27.5 to 28.35 gigahertz, the 28 gigahertz band, 38.6 to 40 gigahertz, the 39 gigahertz band, and 37 to 38.6 gigahertz, the 37 gigahertz band. It also authorizes unlicensed operations under Part 15 of the Commission's rules in the 64 to 71 gigahertz band. The item adopts a flexible licensing, service, and technical rule framework that applies to the bands in the report and order and serves as the foundation for the bands raised in the FNPRM. The 28 gigahertz band, 39 gigahertz band, and the 37.6 to 38.6 gigahertz portion of the 37 gigahertz band will be made available using geographic area licensing. The 28 gigahertz band will be licensed on a county basis, and the other bands will be licensed on a partial economic area basis. The 28 gigahertz band will be licensed as two 425 megahertz channels, while the 37.6 to 40 gigahertz band will be licensed in 200 megahertz channels. The 37 to 37.6 gigahertz band segment will be shared on a coordinated co-equal basis between commercial and federal users. This item sets in place a structure with defined rights that can then serve as a foundation for collaboration among interested parties on a sharing mechanism to be further developed through the FNPRM. Non-federal users will be licensed by rule and must register individual site locations. The item proposes licensing rules that will provide licensees with the maximum flexibility to meet consumer demand. We adopt performance requirements for mobile, fixed, and point-to-multipoint operations. The technical rules provide licensees with the maximum flexibility possible to deploy the technology they choose while avoiding harmful interference. Further, the item adopts a band-wide operability requirement for mobile and transportable equipment. The item also adopts rules to promote both competition and security in the development and deployment of new services in the millimeter wave bands. The Part 15 rules for unlicensed use of the 64 to 71 gigahertz band are based on our existing rules for the 57 to 64 gigahertz band. Opening up the 64 to 71 gigahertz band for unlicensed use will create 14 gigahertz of contiguous spectrum for innovative unlicensed uses. In addition, the item adopts rules to facilitate greater satellite use of the 28 gigahertz, 37 gigahertz, and 39 gigahertz bands on a shared basis, without unduly limiting terrestrial use of those bands. Existing authorized 28 gigahertz satellite earth stations and earth stations with applications pending at the time of adoption and subsequently approved will be grandfathered. Satellite operators will also have multiple methods for deploying additional earth stations. While the fixed satellite service will remain secondary to fixed and mobile operations in the relevant bands, satellite operators will have a new limited right under which they may place earth stations in a set number of locations in each terrestrial license area without having to protect the terrestrial licensee. Specifically, they may locate 3 earth stations per license area, with several limitations designed to provide the terrestrial licensee with predictability regarding the possible locations. With respect to concerns raised about aggregate interference to satellite receivers in the 28 gigahertz band, the item concludes that the likelihood of such interference is low and declines to adopt any specific protections, but encourages the satellite and wireless industries to continue to study the issue and to submit relevant data and analyses to the Commission. The Commission reserves the right to revisit this issue if necessary. The further notice of proposed rulemaking proposes to examine 18 gigahertz of additional spectrum to determine whether those bands would be suitable for mobile use. The FNPRM also seeks further comment on several other issues, including the sharing mechanism for the 37 to 37.6 gigahertz band, allowing satellites in the 37.5 to 40 gigahertz band to radiate higher power and to operate user equipment on a non-protected basis, adopting performance requirements for innovative uses such as machine-to-machine communications, and making unused portions of exclusive licensed bands available for shared use after the performance requirement deadlines, while protecting licensees' rights to expand operations in the future. The Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, the Office of Engineering and Technology, and the International Bureau recommend adoption of this item and request editorial privileges. Thank you.
Well done. Mr. Clyburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'm about to ask a question that might seem odd coming from this side of the bench, particularly since this body stands minutes away from taking, and I quote, a significant step towards securing the nation's future in the next generational evolution of wireless technology. Mr. Chairman, just what is 5G? Today's vote is both a monumental step as well as a perfect example of why I am so excited about the direction we are headed when it comes to spectrum policy. Breaking away from the conventional model of exclusive, indefinite licenses. Innovative sharing rules for bands and in frequencies we never dreamed possible. All of this affirms just how serious we are about meeting the communications bandwidth needs of our citizens. But I am willing to bet that your answer to the question, what is 5G, would be different from the person sitting next to you and the next person and the next. Nonetheless, what we do know and can all agree is that the next wireless evolution promises to fundamentally change the way we live, interact, and engage with our communities. Indeed, there is seemingly no limit on how what we refer to as 5G could impact our everyday existence. A refrigerator that not only alerts you to a near empty egg carton, but automatically adds that item to a virtual shopping list, enabling a delivery to your door by week's end without any action from you. Or a piece of equipment in a factory that automatically pings a repair person at headquarters about a potential malfunction well before the machine shuts down. a remote surgery being performed in the Alaskan bush by a preeminent surgeon thousands of miles away. Some of our cities already have smart technologies, such as New York City's Link NYC free public Wi-Fi network, which I had the pleasure of seeing in May as part of my Connecting Communities tour, or Boston's solar-powered benches that not only charge gadgets, but also monitor air quality and sound levels. And all of this will become even more prevalent in a 5G world. But what is inspiring to many and to me are the possibilities we have yet to conceive, those truly extraordinary use cases that we are on the cusp of realizing. What an exciting new frontier. And today's order provides a strong framework that promises to unleash more innovation, spur additional competition, and incite boundless creativity. And if that were not enough, what is even more thrilling is the fact that America is leading the way. Each of us has worked diligently to craft a regulatory regime that carefully balances the needs of all stakeholders invested in the future of the 28 gigahertz, 37 gigahertz, and 39 gigahertz band. This order also provides room for innovators to develop pioneering products in the 67 to 71 gigahertz unlicensed band, which opens up a whole new range of possibilities. And in the further notice, we identified 18 gigahertz of additional spectrum for 5G use cases and seek comment on the use of bands above 95 gigahertz. But in the midst of all of this excitement and promise, as we collectively figure out just what 5G is, let us not forget that there are pockets in this nation where people are still living in a 2G and 3G reality. They include the underserved and the unserved, who are just as anxious to reap the benefits of successful spectrum policies as you and me. When we think about what the goals of our next generation networks should be, ubiquity and affordability have to be a part of the success matrix, for we must be sure that we are not just giving those who already have the most even more, while doubling down and widening the digital divide for those with none or not enough because of lack of forethought when setting the standards and business cases for 5G. We need to be as creative, flexible, and forward-thinking on the community and opportunities inclusion fronts as we are on the technological innovations front. There must be room for service offerings that benefit those in urban high-rent districts as well as those who are struggling on the rural prairies. We must think of ways to leverage both fixed and mobile 5G for the currently unconnected and make a solid commercial case for doing so. America will only truly win the 5G race if all of our citizens benefit, and it is my sincere hope as we strive to ensure competitive opportunities that we deliver ubiquitous rewards to everyone. I would like to thank John Wilkins, Julie Knapp, Mendel Della Torre, and the staff of the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, the Office of Engineering and Technology, and the International Bureau for their commendable work on this item. And a special thank you goes to Brian Regan and Albuquerque, for I am grateful for your tireless efforts on this item and ever more excited to discover, along with you, all of the cutting-edge innovations that await us in 2020 and beyond.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rosenworth.
Thanks. Today, the United States leads the world in the deployment of the current generation of wireless technology known as 4G. While we are home to less than 5% of the globe's population, we have one-third of all 4G subscriptions worldwide. So far, so good. But if we want our wireless future to be bold, we need to do more than rest on our 4G laurels. We need to focus on what's next. And 5G services are poised to provide speeds more than 10 times faster than today's 4G networks. The increased speeds of 5G service will change the ways we communicate, multiplying the ways we use video, as images increasingly replace what is done today by text. The reduced latency of 5G service will clear the way for augmented and virtual reality, creating new teaching tools and entertainment experiences. And the lower energy demands of 5G service will lay the groundwork for new efficiency gains from the Internet of Things. The race to 5G is on. The world's wireless economies are busy planning for 5G. South Korea and Japan have plans to deploy 5G services by the times they hold the Olympics in 2018 and 2020, respectively. And to meet these goals, carriers in these countries are already conducting field trials. Earlier this year, the European Commission announced work on a 5G action plan in addition to work that they are already doing with China, where three of the nation's ministries have jointly established a group to promote the development of 5G services. So even though standardization is still underway and commercialization may not occur until the end of the decade, work is being done worldwide. I saw some of this myself in our own backyard when I spent time at the National Institute of Standards and Technology last week. We have cutting-edge millimeter wave research that is taking place with assistance from both academia and industry. We are making real progress. But for 5G technology to truly take off and for the United States to win this race, we need spectrum, and lots of it. So I'm pleased to support our efforts today to authorize mobile use in the 28, 37, and 39 gigahertz bands. Collectively, this represents over 3 gigahertz of spectrum that will become available for licensed use. We also have a cut for unlicensed, or what I call the Wi-Fi dividend, in the 64 to 71 gigahertz band. And these airwaves can be combined with a swath of unlicensed spectrum that is nearby, meaning new and exciting possibilities for Wi-Gig innovation. We also seek comment on opportunities in spectrum above 95 gigahertz. At the same time, we take steps to protect incumbent satellite operations that rely on this high-band spectrum. We allow for their continued growth and commit to carefully monitoring the impact of terrestrial use on their operations. This is important. However, we need to remember that airwaves alone are not enough. In wireless policy, spectrum gets all the glory. But if we want to be truly bold with 5G service, we need to focus our efforts on the ground as well as on the skies. And here's why. Today, the bulk of our 4G wireless networks are built on spectrum from 600 megahertz to 3 gigahertz. But our 5G future is going to look different, very different. That's because today, right here and now, we are busting through that old 3 gigahertz ceiling and developing real opportunities in much higher band airwaves. This is spectrum that is way, way up there. These are the airwaves that take us to infinity and beyond. But with these stratospheric frequencies come propagation challenges. And while these super high frequencies can carry a significant amount of data, they do not go far. But we can turn that limitation into a strength by combining these frequencies with small cells packed close together, densifying networks at lower cost. And this all works if we come up with policies and practices that facilitate small cell deployment. In other words, with 5G networks, small cells are a big thing. So we need to think beyond traditional tower siting. And already we have taken steps to streamline our historic preservation and environmental review process for small cells. We also have adopted rules to implement the parts of the Middle Class Tax Relief and Job Creation Act that tighten the local review process for facilities that do not substantially change the dimensions of existing structures. This is good, but more work is necessary. Because by law and tradition, we honor local control in this country. But at the same time, we should reward communities that take steps to put in place the infrastructure we need for our 5G future. For outdoor deployments, we should work with communities across the country and help develop model practices. We should also hold a contest and reward the cities that put 5G infrastructure in place as part of the broader Smart Cities initiative that was kicked off last year. In addition, we need to look at the in-building equation. I think the time has come for the broadband and wireless equivalent of LEED certification. Because the market should reward buildings that have dense networks of small cells and fiber and backhaul needed for 5G service. New York City already has a similar program in place, thanks to the efforts of Mayor Bloomberg, who started a program to identify buildings with truly high-speed broadband. We need to build on this idea and extend it to communities across the country. Because as we all know about the Big Apple, if you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. There are a lot of challenges ahead, but we are on the cusp of cars that drive themselves, streets that can be safer, emergency services that are more effective, healthcare that is more personalized, and more capability across the board because we are more connected. Because while 4G technology brought the smartphone to pockets and purses everywhere, the benefits of 5G technology are bigger, bolder, and more diffuse. They will be felt throughout the economy. How? Well, we're just getting started. But there are possibilities everywhere. Imagine if we rewarded the city that cut commute times the most. It would take sensors in streetlights, roadside architecture, and cars to see where traffic patterns could be more efficient and public transportation more effective. 5G technology can help make that happen. And imagine if we introduced cameras and the helmets of our firefighters. They could relay video back to colleagues outside who could direct a team of firefighters in real time, enhancing safety for public safety and those who they rescue. 5G technology can make it happen. Imagine if we monitored urban trees with sensors to help assess air quality and develop strategies for dealing with drought. Los Angeles is already looking into this project called the Internet of Trees, and 5G technology can make it happen. That's what the wireless future looks like. It is so much more than the devices in our palms today. And to get there, we need to do more than rest on our 4G laurels. And with our efforts here today with millimeter wave spectrum, we are doing just that. Because the race to 5G is on, and the future belongs to the connected. Thank you to the team who worked on this item. We appreciate your efforts.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. Commissioner Pai.
A decade ago, the smartphone didn't exist. Today, over 70% of American consumers cradle them in the palms of their hands. And an artist like Adele is subjected to intense scrutiny when she uses a flip phone to say hello in a music video. Not long ago, cars, appliances, and other machines were analog islands unto themselves. Today, we are at the dawn of the Internet of Things, with 15 billion internet-connected devices and 50 billion expected by 2020. Many years ago, wireless was a fraction of all IP traffic, and only spectrum below 3 gigahertz was thought to be suitable for mobile. Today, the forecast is that wireless devices will account for two-thirds of all IP traffic, and the vistas for spectrum extend up into the triple digits. Changes like these are forcing everyone to rethink the wireless networks in this country and to start planning for our 5G future. Now, thankfully, American entrepreneurs and innovators are rising to meet the challenge of our highly interconnected world. They are investing in the research and development necessary for the United States to extend its leadership in the mobile space to the next generation of wireless technologies. I've seen these efforts firsthand, from Samsung's 5G research lab near Dallas, Texas, to Intel's demonstration of its millimeter wave technology here at the FCC's headquarters. And just this week, Verizon completed the technical specifications for its 5G deployment, which should help accelerate the technological push forward. Now today, the FCC does its part to pace the wireless revolution. In this order, we open up over 10 gigahertz of high-band spectrum for innovative mobile use. In the further notice, we start the process of bringing perhaps twice as much online. And on many of the most important policy questions, we supply answers that should allow American consumers to enjoy a mobile experience that is the envy of the world. I'd like to highlight this morning just a few of those decisions. First, I'm glad that we are including a number of additional spectrum bands in our further notice. In particular, I'm pleased that we now have the votes to examine the 12,500 megahertz of spectrum in the 24 gigahertz, 32 gigahertz, 42 gigahertz, 70 gigahertz, and 80 gigahertz bands. Commissioner O'Reilly and I urged our colleagues to include those bands in last year's notice. In our view, the Commission should have teed up as many bands as possible and let innovators and entrepreneurs tell us what might work. Happily, persistence has paid off. Today, the Commission speaks with one voice in promoting the potential of those 12,500 megahertz of spectrum for flexible mobile use. Likewise, I want to take a minute to thank my colleagues for agreeing to expand the further notice to include spectrum bands above 95 gigahertz. Now, getting to this point was no small feat. Petitioners asked the FCC to adopt service rules for these bands years ago. In the meantime, other countries, as well as companies here in the United States, have been looking for ways to put the spectrum to more productive use. I've been told that our lack of service rules might be holding us back. Now, one might think that these bands are way out there, spectrally speaking, but that's not a reason to artificially restrict them. Again, let's get the spectrum out there and let the engineers help us decide. I'm happy to report that we were able to reach a compromise that puts these bands at long last on the table. Second, I'm glad that we are now placing an even greater emphasis on fostering innovation and investment in the millimeter wave bands. For instance, the order abandons the so-called hybrid licensing scheme that the 2015 notice proposed for the 37 gigahertz band. In my view, that complex regime would have inhibited investment and innovation. We also appropriately leave behind the complicated performance metrics proposed in the 2015 notice. Back then, I urged my colleagues to include questions about more straightforward approaches. And now, the order adopts those simpler, well-established methods of determining whether licensees are putting their spectrum to use. We also adopt renewal expectancies for these license bands, which should help encourage investment. And in another positive step, the further notice now seeks comment on whether we should apply our traditional licensing mechanisms to the additional spectrum bands, rather than experimenting with far more complicated regimes. Third, I'm glad that the relief that we are providing today isn't limited solely to traditional mobile technologies. Earlier this year, in Mountain View, I had the pleasure of visiting with Google's Advanced Technology and Projects, or ATAP, group. One of the most intriguing things they showed me was Project Soli. Founder and team lead Ivan Puparev described how Project Soli has created a sensing technology that uses miniature radar to detect the smallest of hand gestures. Imagine being able to control your smartphone, your watch, or virtually any device with a slight movement of your clasped thumb and index finger. Imagine the benefits that technologies like that could bring to so many individuals, for example, those with disabilities. One testbed for this kind of technology is in the 60 gigahertz band, which is technically well-suited for enabling machines to see subtle physical gestures. And so I'm glad that my colleagues agreed with my suggestion to take additional steps today that will make it easier for entrepreneurs at ATAP and everywhere else to experiment with joining the physical and the digital worlds. Now, none of this is to say that I agree with every single decision the Commission makes today. Take the cybersecurity portion of the order. In my view, we lack the expertise and the authority to dive headlong into this issue. And I don't think any agency should take a band-by-band approach to cyber. These are issues that are better left for security experts to handle in a more comprehensive way. However, I do appreciate that my colleagues revised portions of the cybersecurity discussion in light of some of my concerns. Another area where I would have taken a different tack is mobile spectrum holdings. As I've emphasized, experience shows that markets distorted by preemptive government dictates don't ultimately benefit consumers. Nonetheless, because we could be years away from any high-band spectrum auctions, I hope that we'll have time to correct course before these limits apply. I also would have struck a different balance when it comes to spectrum held by the federal government. We must continue to be as aggressive as possible when it comes to identifying and freeing up spectrum bands that could serve American consumers. But none of the concerns I've just expressed overshadow the merits of the broader compromise that we reach today. And so I'll be concurring with these portions of the decision. Last, and arguably most, I want to say a word about the professional staff of the FCC, the engineers, the lawyers, and the others who put in the countless hours necessary for us to reach this point today. All of you deserve tremendous credit. It is one thing for us to pontificate, and pontificate we do. It is quite another thing for you to produce, and produce you did. In less than 2 years, you pushed this proceeding from a notice of inquiry to an order, and you pushed this country from virtually no high-band spectrum to more than 10 gigahertz of it. In the regulatory context, that is moving at the speed of light. And I know that a lot of negotiating and a good deal of compromise with federal users was involved, and so I want to commend you for those efforts. When the United States hopefully takes the worldwide lead in developing 5G technologies, it will be due in no small part to your efforts, efforts that have matched the speed of change in the marketplace itself. So thank you in particular to the staff of the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, particularly the Broadband Division, and the staff in the Office of Engineering and Technology, the International Bureau, and the Office of General Counsel for all of the contributions that you have made. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner O'Reilly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a longer statement that I'll submit for the record, but I want to make some points. After much hard work, the item before us is in fairly good shape and earns my general support. But we are at the early stages of development. Most industry participants believe that the next generation, or 5G networks, will incorporate millimeter wave spectrum to achieve the capacity, speed, and latency needs of America's wireless users. Not only will these frequencies be used to provide data-intensive applications such as advanced video downloads and gaming capabilities, but will also be used with our current 4G deployments to incorporate the vast and expanding Internet of Things. Today, the U.S. becomes the first country to allocate spectrum for the next generation wireless networks. I've stated repeatedly, and my colleagues agree, that we must maintain our position as a world leader in wireless innovation. Other nations, such as South Korea, China, Japan, seek to challenge our status. We are ideally situated to usher in the next wave of wireless technologies based on our preeminence and experience gained in deploying 4G technologies. We are solidifying this leadership role by opening up the 28, 37, 39, and 64 to 71 gigahertz for mobile use. I appreciate that the item, as promised to me, seeks comment in the further notice on 7 new bands to open up for additional wireless uses. However, I am sure that no one will be surprised that I will continue to push for even more bandwidth, especially those that are being studied in preparation for the next World Radio Communications Conference. While I've been critical of the events that I witnessed at Work 15 and its decision to not study certain frequencies, such as 28 gigahertz, this does not mean that we should ignore our future needs. A main role of the Commission is to provide the necessary spectrum resources and then let the private sector take technology to meet consumer demands. In the same vein, we must also provide a regulatory environment that offers licensees necessary flexibility and certainty to allow investment, innovation, and deployment of next-generation systems. While I'm supportive of the actions we take today, there are several licensing issues that, in my opinion, would have benefited from further consideration and I suspect we'll be revisiting in the future. These include licensing in the 28 gigahertz band by counties as opposed to larger market areas or such as a P, which has been rejected by almost everyone in the record. Allowing shared use in the lower 600 megahertz of the 37 gigahertz band between the federal government users and multiple commercial users, and concerns that the operability requirement for the 37 to 40 gigahertz. How fixed satellite service earth stations should be protected and how they should be sited going forward. And the potential direction of some sharing proposals raised in the further notice. I must dissent, however, to two areas. First is the spectrum aggregation limits imposed in this order and the mobile spectrum holdings discussion in the further notice. Generally, I oppose spectrum caps in favor of the free market, but in this case, it makes absolutely no sense to impose any limits. We do not have a consensus definition of 5G, as my colleagues have highlighted. Finalized standards, a full understanding of what services will be offered, or any idea of how much spectrum is needed to achieve the capacity, speed, and latency goals for particular spectrum bands. But we adopt this foolish policy anyway. Although improvements have been made since the item was originally circulated, I also cannot support the security section of this order requiring a high-level statement of every licensee's security plans. While I fully support secure networks, wireless providers have every incentive to ensure the soundness of their networks. A lack of security measures, or even worse, a security breach, results in a loss of subscribers, which is not a successful business plan. Therefore, I do not believe that this reporting requirement is necessary or all that helpful. I also cannot support the delegation of authority to the Public Safety Bureau to release an NOI seeking comment on the security implications and solutions in future 5G networks. Now that the Commission has identified spectrum for the next generation networks, we must finish up the proceeding to further reduce regulatory burdens on small cell deployments. I understand that we're getting close, and I commend the Bureau for its work. Once this is done, we must refocus our energy on ensuring that localities cannot put unnecessary roadblocks in front of small cell siting. I want to thank the Chairman for incorporating some of my edits and suggestions, and a special thanks to the multi-bureau and office teams who worked together tirelessly to get this item done so quickly. Although I may have made some different choices along the way, I recognize the amount of work of effort that went into this product. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. I've spoken at length on this topic, and now is not the time to do an instant replay of that. But I do believe that this is one of the, if not the most important decision this agency will make this year. By becoming the first nation to identify high band spectrum, the United States is ushering in the 5G era of high capacity, high speed, low latency wireless networks. By not getting involved in the technologies that will use the spectrum, we're turning loose the incredible innovators of this country. To answer the question that Commissioner Clyburn raised, and to double down on the examples that Commissioner Rosenworcel gave. And with our oversight to protect competition, we assure that the forces that drive that innovation and improve consumer service are alive and well. I want to join with my colleagues in recognizing the significant work over a very focused period of time of the people sitting before us and those that you represent, and I want to pick on you by name. Mindell De La Torre and the International Bureau got us to this point, despite the fact that the ITU and others didn't want us to get here. Commissioner O'Reilly and I were together with Mindell and her team in Geneva at the WARC conference, where every effort was made to stop this kind of progress. You did not let that stop you, and you got the kind of carve-outs that we need in our international agreements to allow us to proceed in this region of the world, and that was the seminal moment that started us to this process. Julie Knapp, head of OET, picks up the ball because this is spectrum that's already being used. And how do you coordinate with other users who include not only, as some up here have mentioned, the satellite industry and others, but the Defense Department and some rather significant players in our government and national security? And Julie worked his way through those kinds of issues. We heard about the evolution of this rulemaking in some of the comments. Thanks to Julie and his team's leadership. And John Wilkins, the new chief of the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau. Then the ball keeps getting passed down the table here, as you can see, and now it falls in John's lap. And John's team worked to construct the structures as to how do you make this work economically with existing licensees? How do you make things fold together? How do you have expectations going forward? And to John will fall the kind of issues that have been mentioned up here about how we make sure the infrastructure gets built out. And each of them I have called by name because their leadership has been exemplar, but none of us up here are under any illusions that there isn't behind those three a significant team, many of whom are sitting up here, who've made this all happen. This is a big day for our nation. This is a big day for this agency. We thank you all very, very much, and I will call for the vote. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? The item is carried. The request for editorial privileges is granted with the objection noted. The item is adopted. Madam Secretary, tell us where we go next.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, the next item on your agenda today will be presented by the Wireline Competition Bureau and is entitled Technology Transitions. And Matt Del Nero, Chief of the Bureau, will give the introduction.
Mr. Del Nero, the floor is yours, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners.
Good morning.
The Wireline Competition Bureau is pleased to present for your consideration today an item on the ongoing technology transitions. Evolution in wireline networks have not been measured in clearly defined generations, but it's clear that we are in a momentous and powerful time of change. And the item before you seeks to provide regulatory clarity for these technology transitions and to remove obstacles that might impede them. It proceeds in three parts. First, a declaratory ruling that finds incumbent local exchange carriers are non-dominant in their provision of interstate switched access services. Second, a report and order establishing a framework for evaluating discontinuance applications related to technology transitions under Section 214 of the Communications Act. And third, an order on reconsideration addressing a small gap in the interplay between our copper retirement and discontinuance rules. The resulting item eliminates obsolete requirements and modernizes other rules to help the nation's communications infrastructure get from here to there in a way that safeguards and promotes competition, consumer protection, universal service, and public safety and national security. It is, as some have said, a values-driven transition. With me at the table are Carol Maddy from the Wireline Front Office, Dan Kahn, from the Competition Policy Division, and also from the division, Peter Saharko and Megan Capasso. And if I may mention that Peter has very kindly timed the birth of his next child to be slightly after this meeting. His wife is...
How slightly?
She's 37 weeks. So if he has to leave in the middle,
right,
you'll know why. I thank my colleagues at the table for their efforts in producing the item. As well as Christine Fargetstein, Michelle Burlove, Heather Hendrickson, Brian Hurley, Alex John, Kathy Zima, Alec McDonald, Ziad Sleem, and others in the Bureau. And also, we are grateful to the contributions from the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau, the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, and the Disabilities Rights Office of the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau. Megan will now present the item.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners.
Good morning.
Technology transitions demand regulatory transitions, meaning the Commission must adapt to new realities while ensuring that our fundamental values are preserved. The proposed actions we present for your consideration today are aimed at promoting those values. First, we propose to grant U.S. Telecom's petition for a declaratory ruling and remove the outdated designation of incumbent carriers as dominant in the legacy switched access marketplace. The proposed declaratory ruling would find that inter-carrier compensation reforms have divested ILECs of market power over these services. Second, the proposed report and order would adopt an updated approach for Section 214 discontinuance applications involving a transition from a legacy voice service to a new technology, whether IP or wireless. This framework would establish clear standards for what is necessary to be eligible for streamlined processing, which will accelerate approval of these applications. It would also promote speedy technology transitions while protecting our core values. However, applicants will be free to proceed under the traditional five-factor approach if they so choose. Under the proposed framework, applicants must certify or show that an adequate replacement exists in order to be eligible for automatic grant. The order would adopt a three-pronged adequate replacement test. To be eligible for streamlined treatment under this test, an adequate replacement service must, one, offer substantially similar network performance and service quality, two, ensure that critical applications remain available, and three, guarantee interoperability with key applications. To satisfy the first prong, an applicant must demonstrate that at least one service provides substantially similar network performance as the service being discontinued, substantially similar service availability, and coverage to the entire affected geographic service area. The order would exempt small businesses from the network performing testing requirements. To satisfy the second prong, at least one replacement service must comply with existing Commission 911 regulations, provide effective protection from network security risks, and comply with Commission rules to ensure service availability for individuals with disabilities. To satisfy the third prong, a replacement service must be compatible with fax machines, home security alarms, medical monitoring devices, analog-only captioned telephone sets, and point-of-sale terminals. These interoperability requirements would sunset in 2025. Additionally, the order would allow affected customers to receive notice by email if they've requested it. The order also includes guidelines on customer education and outreach. Moreover, any material increase in price for the proposed replacement service over the price of the service to be discontinued will prevent streamlined processing of the application. Finally, the order on reconsideration would make a minor change in the timing of a Section 214 discontinuance to avoid a competitive carrier falling out of compliance with our rules through no fault of its own. The order on reconsideration determines that a competitive carrier's timely discontinuance of service application will be deemed granted on the date of the retirement. The Bureau recommends adoption of this item and requests editorial privileges. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan. Well done. Commissioner Clyburn.
During my travels across the country over the past 4 months as part of my Connecting Communities tour, I have seen powerful examples of how modern communications technology can make a positive impact in rural and urban communities. In May, I saw how Charleston County's consolidated 911 center in North Charleston, South Carolina, is using the power of IP communications to improve service reliability for its community. And last month, as I witnessed how the administrators at Palo Alto's Lucille Packard Children's Hospital have embraced the use of telehealth and electronic medical records to improve patient care outcomes, I marveled at just how far we have come from when we first adopted the emerging wireline order. Now I am thinking about how far we still need to go. For decades, consumers have come to expect that when they pick up their telephone, whether it's to contact emergency personnel during a natural or man-made disaster, or simply reconnect with a loved one, that that call will be completed. However, the basic infrastructure delivering those telephone calls is changing. Copper lines are being replaced by optical fiber, and sometimes wires are being replaced by wireless technology. Today's order is our means of ensuring that consumers will receive in the future what they expect now, reliable and secure voice service. While a few providers have already undergone these technology transitions, much change is still ahead, change we need to evaluate carefully. I am pleased to say we will have a chance to do just that, thanks to the authority granted to the Commission under Section 214 of the Communications Act. The statute requires the Commission to determine whether it is in the public interest for a carrier to discontinue service, and it is our duty to ensure that consumers continue to receive critical service functionality like calling 911 and having that operator know where they are located. That is why we need to carefully evaluate any proposed discontinuances in the context of technology transitions to ensure that there is an adequate substitute for services poised to be discontinued. This is particularly critical when it comes to the most vulnerable in our society, for we cannot have, nor can we afford to have, a disconnected community of low-income, elderly, or disabled citizens as a result of any technology transition. How do we best realize this? I have said this before and will repeat it again, robust consumer education. It is unfortunate that this transition does not have the type of funding that enabled the FCC staff to travel the country to ensure that consumers were notified like that during the DTV transition. Nonetheless, I am pleased that the item contains a requirement that carriers develop and disperse educational materials to all consumers who will be affected by any transition. It also makes available trained staff to answer consumer questions about technology transitions. I am also grateful that the item contains my suggestion to expand the availability of consumer hotline, the hours, beyond the normal business hours and make consumer education materials available in other languages. Consumers who cannot get to a phone during what is referred to as regular business hours, which is not so regular if you work a shift, are not so proficient in telecom English, can get their transition questions answered in a way in which they can understand just what is going on with their vital communication service. We also must look out for those who are price sensitive, like the currently unemployed or those on fixed income. A new fiber line that results in an unaffordable service is a technology that does not hold out much promise for those most in need. So we must make sure that the next great thing in voice is not actually a foreclosed opportunity for some, masquerading as progress for all. And while I am pleased that the item contains my suggestion that material changes in cost of a replacement service can be the basis for an application to not receive streamlined treatment, I believe a broader opportunity has been missed. We could have ensured that affordability was truly a linchpin of the discontinuance analysis and that the particularly price sensitive receive special consideration when service providers are discontinuing service. However, I am comforted that this item has changed to improve consideration for a discontinuance's impact on these vulnerable populations for whom voice service is particularly vital. I would like to thank the staff of the Wireline Competition Bureau for their hard work on this item, which seeks to ensure that consumers remain protected during these important technology transitions.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rosenworcel.
Today we are focused on the future because our networks are changing. To understand how, take a look at the not-so-distant past. A year ago, when we last visited the issues in this proceeding, there were 85 million traditional phone lines across the country, down from nearly 200 million at the turn of the millennium. But now, our most recent data show that the number of traditional phone lines has fallen yet again to 73 million lines. That's a decrease of 14% in 1 year alone. Meanwhile, Americans are increasingly choosing other ways to communicate, including a growing number of VoIP and wireless connections. This is what network change looks like, and our decision today recognizes this reality and embraces this change. It has my full support. We acknowledge that our traditional distinction between certain dominant and non-dominant services is both out of date and out of touch. As a result, we change our policy framework for incumbent providers offering interstate switched access. This means less red tape and a more competitive playing field. We also provide a clear path for providers to retire legacy services and move to next generation voice technologies. while ensuring key functions like access to 911 are available over what is new and what is next. Finally, our decision takes steps to make sure that consumers are informed about network change, and this is critical. We require providers to develop outreach plans and keep users informed about how network updates can affect their service. There are four values that have always informed our communications policy: public safety, universal access, competition, and consumer protection. They have capably guided us in the past. They are supported in our decision here today, and I believe they can continue to guide us as we navigate the network change in our future. So thank you to the Wireline Bureau, and I'm just going to say that my daughter was born at 37 weeks.
Is your phone on? I left it upstairs. Quick, let's vote this item. Okay. Commissioner Pye.
Good luck, Peter. Is all I can say. There are some movie franchises that you just love. James Bond thrills, Terminator explodes with action, and Rocky inspires. But not every iteration of a franchise has the same magic. Recall The Living Daylights, Terminator Salvation, or Rocky Balboa, if you can. It's not that these are terrible films, there's just not much going for them. This order, the latest in our IP transition franchise, carries forward that tradition. The order claims to advance that transition, something that I certainly support. Indeed, for each of the years that the 4 years that I've served on the commission, I've been calling on the FCC to expedite the IP transition, to end the burdensome regulations that tie up carrier resources and slow the deployment of next-generation networks. And the headlines accompanying today's release are catchy. It will strip away the outdated and unnecessary. It will modernize our rules, and it will maximize opportunities for creative disruption. But like too many summer blockbusters, this film doesn't live up to the trailer. In a world where consumers are embracing the IP transition in growing numbers each and every day, this agency shouldn't be timid. And yet we are. The highlights of this order include letting incumbents file certain tariffs a few days later, correcting a technicality regarding copper retirement, and automatically granting petitions to discontinue services with no customers. Not much action there. And the bulk of the order is devoted to laying out the various tests, the numerous conditions, and the multiple obligations of carriers who volunteer to undergo a streamlined discontinuance process for voice services, a framework sure to scare away most, if not all, volunteers, and thus unlikely to have much, if any, practical impact. And so, much like the final season of Lost, that recent James Patterson novel, and every Super Bowl halftime show since Janet Jackson, there's just not that much new being revealed. That said, I do approve of the limited relief granted, and I concur on the remainder of the order. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Did I say something? Commissioner O'Reilly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree wholeheartedly with the Commission's assessment that there's been an indisputable societal and technological shift away from switched telephone service as a fixture of American life. While switched access service once dominated the landscape, demand for the services plummeted as consumers have switched to wireless and VoIP platforms to the extent that they make calls at all. Instead, consumers have voluntarily switched to a degree for some and to a considerable amount for others to text, email, video chat, and social networking applications to meet their communication needs. I'm pleased that the Commission recognizes this and has finally issued a declaratory ruling granting U.S. Telecom's long-pending petition for relief from dominant carrier regulations with respect to switched access voice. While I would have decided the petition on broader grounds and provided even greater relief, any step to remove unnecessary regulation is a step in the right direction. However, I find it hard to reconcile the Commission's findings in the declaratory ruling that consumers are increasingly able and willing to abandon their landline in favor of communication technologies that do not rely on the local telephone switches, with the statement in the second report in order that the special and long-standing importance of voice service to consumers warning warrants develop additional criteria for streamlined treatment during technological transitions. This particular technology transition is nearly over. The item states that almost 75% of U.S. residential consumers, approximately 88 million households, no longer receive telephone service over traditional copper facilities. If it were so important to adopt criteria to ensure consumers receive an adequate replacement, that train has left the station years ago. The millions of consumers that have already abandoned legacy voice service seem to have their own criteria in mind, and there is a plethora of options that apparently meet those criteria. To the extent that legacy voice service remains special to some consumers, the Commission could continue to ensure that consumers receive adequate notice of discontinuances so that they can plan accordingly. But in general, the proper role for the Commission at this stage is to remove obstacles to innovation and consumer choice, not create new ones. When I think of a streamlined process for discontinuing legacy services, I envision a fast-tracked applications for services that are no longer widely used by consumers. It would not entail things like three more prongs, network testing, cybersecurity certifications, promises to support fax machines for another 9 years, or a totality of the circumstances review, whatever that means. Only FCC can create a process that imports all of the existing rules, adds some new ones, makes no assurances about timing, and call it streamlined with a straight face. And let's face facts, that despite how it's portrayed, this new process is going to be the sole standard for getting Commission approval on such matters. I'm not surprised that the Commission goes to great length to stress how voluntary this process is, because it does not actually comport with Section 214 of the Act. I do not begrudge any carrier that decides to take advantage of the new process. However, I do not support the expansion of Section 214 to implicitly regulate new services by effectively subjecting replacement offerings to rules originally adopted for legacy voice service. The Commission is further extending its regulatory outreach and overreach, and that is a terrible precedent. Even worse, the Commission uses this optional process as an excuse to create cybersecurity requirements for replacement offerings that never applied to legacy voice services. As I have said many times, the Commission has no authority to adopt cybersecurity requirements. Well, I certainly appreciate being lectured at our last meeting that somehow raising objections to illogical network protections was highly irresponsible. Nothing changes the fact that cybersecurity is an important issue, and Congress has assigned authority to oversee it to other agencies. Therefore, I do not support its inclusion in this item, voluntarily or not. Moreover, the cybersecurity section stands in stark contrast to other parts in the item, where the Commission concludes this is not the appropriate forum in which to impose new substantive requirements. Of course, the Commission falls back on the familiar refrain that new cybersecurity requirements are limited to the voluntary process. But the Commission consistently dispelled the notion that its foray into cybersecurity is either limited or voluntary. Regarding the order on reconsideration, I support the common sense fix to ensure that competitive LECs are not potentially liable for violating our discontinuance rules for reasons entirely outside their control. In sum, I thank the chairman and staff for working with me to come to resolution on the declaratory ruling, but I had hoped to see more progress made to remove legacy rules and barriers to discontinue services that most consumers no longer use. 2.5 years ago, when the Commission set up a voluntary process for tech transition trials, it was so laden with conditions that there were almost no participants. I am skeptical that this latest voluntary process will be any different. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. You know, there are multiple responsibilities of this agency that aren't a laughing matter. We have responsibility to encourage new technology. We have a responsibility for consumer protection. We have a responsibility for national security. And what we're dealing with today is where all of those come together as the way in which networks operate evolves from Professor Bell's analog model to the new digital model. But just because operations change, obligations do not. And what we've called the network compact of the basic responsibilities that those who build and operate networks have to their fellow Americans is unchanged by whether it's analog waveforms or zeros and ones. And so what we've done today is to put in place a structure that reaffirms that and, at the same point in time, says here's how you respect those responsibilities as you go through the transition. So I will call for the yeas and nays. All in favor, say aye. Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it. The item is adopted with the request for editorial privileges granted and the objection noted. Thank you to the Bureau. Madam Secretary, no, not yet. First, fellow colleagues, anything anybody wants to say?
I technically don't have an announcement, but there are a bunch of young people that I assume are going to be acknowledged. And I want to say publicly right now, first, thank you to my staff, who I do not thank enough. But thank you to, I think, some of our interns, and this might be their last round because they said they're going back to school and classes. I'm not sure, but that's what they said. Subject to check, as you got lawyers like to say. But I want to thank them for their service. They've been a really interesting, fun bunch, and I really appreciate their contribution to the office. So thank you very much.
Chris Brosworth. Mike?
No, sir.
Well, I've got a couple of things. One, I'm delighted to announce that Holly Sauer has joined our office, completing the trifecta of now having worked for each of the majority offices on the eighth floor.
I'm here first.
Okay. Well, you know.
You're all the beneficiaries.
Let her know there's no opening in our office.
She comes to us from the Media Bureau, and we're looking forward to working with Holly. Diane Cornell, who's sitting next to her, who has been a fixture from D-Day minus in the chairman's office before we were actually here, is moving on to the International Bureau. The contributions that Diane has made are legion, and we know that she will continue to make those in the International Bureau. I'd also like to say farewell to a couple of our summer law clerks who will depart next week. So, Chavez, stand up so we can embarrass you. Chavez Adams is going to be headed back to Howard University School of Law to finish up his third year, and he's been elected student body vice president, so he's going to go back and do a little of his own political activity. He's also looking forward to being involved in assisting with the upcoming IP initiative at the university. You've sure had some good insights into some of those issues here this summer. He's worked on lifeline issues. He's worked on set-top box issues. And he's been an absolute great addition to the chairman's office. So Godspeed, Chavez. And also leaving us next week will be Amber Lucci. Amber, you stand up. Your turn to get embarrassed. Amber will be going back to complete her second year at the Ohio State University Moritz College of Law and to enjoy Saturday afternoons in the fall and the great tradition that happens at the Horseshoe and that fine institution. She's going to be the staff editor with the university's Journal of Law and Policy for the Information Society. She's been elected a fellow of the university's pro bono research group. And this summer, she has been working with us on the education broadband activities, lifeline issues, process reform issues, working with Diane, and we will miss Amber as well, and her husband,
a Columbus, Ohio police officer will be very happy to have her back after the time that she has spent over here helping us. So, Amber, thank you very much. So there is now I go to Marlene and the what we do next.
Sir.
Something you said jumped in my head, and I want to extend my deep appreciation to Diane Cornell for her professionalism. I want to thank her for her service in the chairman's office, which is no easy task.
I'll second that.
Well, we have maybe not agreed on every item. Diane has tried as hard as possible to find common ground, and I thank her so much for that and wish her best in the International Bureau and success there. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike. Great. Marlene.
The next agenda meeting of the Federal Communications Commission is Thursday, August 4th, 2016.
Only 3 weeks away, folks. Meeting's adjourned. Okay.
Hi, everyone. We're about to start the press conference, so other conversations, can you please take them out to the hallway, please? All right, thank you. Chairman Wheeler has a few words, and we'll take your questions.
Great. Thanks, Kim. So the commission just approved two items that together capture two of the core responsibilities of this agency. One, facilitating technological progress and unleashing all the benefits that come with that. And secondly, preserving the enduring values that, as I said before, those who build and operate networks have always had to American consumers as technology advances. By approving the Spectrum Frontiers Order, the United States becomes the first country in the world to identify and open up vast amounts of high-frequency spectrum for 5G networks and applications. This is the most significant step yet to enable high-speed, high-capacity, low-latency wireless networks that will improve our lives in, as we were discussing today, myriad ways, many yet unimagined, and unlock countless innovations. By approving today's tech transition item, we're updating our rules to reflect changes in the market and the speed of that evolution to move to faster, better networks, while at the same time reaffirming core principles that I think I dubbed when I first came in here, the network compact that exists between those who operate networks and those who use them. When communications networks advance and evolve, new opportunities open up for American consumers. That's why I'm pleased the Commission has taken these significant steps to advance our broadband future. So, be happy to respond to any questions, and since normally I have to egg Todd on from the peanut gallery to ask a question, we'll start with you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Sir.
Needn't egg me on this one. Moments ago, I was attempting to talk to some people who came to attend the meeting and have concerns about radiation and 5G, and one of your security force intervened, told the guy he couldn't show me the T-shirt that he had wished to display at the meeting, forced him to put it away, and confiscated my FCC-issued ID. Is this consonant with the discussion that ought to be taking place here, and what's your reaction to this action by your staff?
I've just heard about it for the first time, Todd. I mean, obviously, this is an open meeting, and I'm sure that if your credentials
have been mistakenly taken, you will get them back. But there is a responsibility for everybody who comes here to behave responsibly.
Is side discussion after the meeting's gaveled out behaving responsibly before you're back in the room?
No, I mean, I think I answered the question, Todd. I mean, the fact of the matter is that that responsible activities, you've seen it before here in the commission room, and everybody has a right to come here, and everybody has the right to behave responsibly, and there are people who are charged with making judgments about that.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Matt Daneman, Communications Daily.
Hey, Matt.
Chairman, during the lead up to the Spectrum Frontiers proceeding, there were a lot of satellite operators who raised a lot of red flags about aggregate interference, about co-primary status, those sorts of things. The commission says that it achieved balance with this. Can you talk about where you see the balance occurring, given that the satellite didn't get very much of what it was seeking whatsoever?
Well, I mean, I think that there were dueling studies back and forth on this issue, which were insufficient to go one way or another. Obviously, we are going to continue the efforts to study the issue, and if it's necessary to re-examine it, we will.
Chairman, let me ask you a two-part question. You just, I guess, came out with this review of the good faith negotiation rules. Can you can you talk to us a little bit about that? And secondly, this is the first time we've had a chance to ask you about the quadrennial review. Can you talk generally about why you decided to leave most of the rules the same, including the bans on newspaper cross-ownership?
David, you're cheating. That's not a two-part question. That's two questions. Which one would you like?
Well, can you start with the good faith review?
And maybe sure. So we announced today that after the conclusion of the NPRM, which Congress told us to do on reviewing the good faith totality of circumstances and the good faith negotiations in retrans, that we would not be going further. And the rationale basically is that totality of circumstances is pretty broad. And if you begin to say, well, now let's look at this or this, or you take this and you end up narrowing it down. And so that was the decision that we made.
Just on the quadrennial review, could you just say, there's been a lot of criticism that much has changed in the last 30 years or so. What was your thought process behind sort of essentially leaving the rules largely unchanged for cross-ownership?
This is an issue has not been voted, is in discussion on the floor right now. Many of the commissioners haven't engaged, and so it's premature to speculate about that, where it comes out. Hi, Lynn.
Hi, Lynn Stanton, TR Daily. At the hearing earlier this week, you had said that, or you agreed to a lawmaker's assessment that the set-top box proposal by the MPVDs has promise, but you also criticized it for lacking detail. I believe you referred to it as a one-page press release. Could you elaborate on what more it is you want them to explain about it beyond
what
they've said?
Well, great. Thanks, Lynn. So, I mean, let's go through a couple of things. What are the goals in this process? One, enforce the statute. The statute's pretty clear. Two, to help consumers who have no choice in set-top boxes and contrary to what the law says, and find themselves in a rigged system where they've got to buy this, they've got to lease this box, just and do it every single month. And third is to make sure that we protect copyright, that we protect the contractual exercise of those copyrights, that we protect privacy and security. So those are the goals that we're trying to achieve here. I'm very happy with the broad participation that that we're having in this. I'm grateful to the industry that they accepted my invitation. I had been saying, as you will recall, for weeks, if not months, let's sit down and talk about details as to how we can meet those kinds of goals. And they were met with a stiff arm. Sitting down to have the discussion with the industry is important. The discussions that we've been having with programmers is equally important. The discussions that we've been having with consumers obviously is important. So I'm very happy about the kind of ongoing dialogue that is occurring around this issue, because it wasn't occurring previously. And I guess that means that we're moving forward. And that's good, because that's what Congress told us to do in Section 629 of the Act. And that's we have a path forward on this, and we're trying to engage in meaningful dialogue with all those who are affected.
Any chance that could you actually answer the question I asked, though, which is, what is it that you want the MVPDs to tell you about their proposal that they haven't told you already?
Jilin, I thought I answered that we are in discussions with them to find out exactly where we can have an accord, because, you know, I mean, I think that's a responsible and meaningful thing to do. Alex?
The privacy, the comment period on the privacy proposal has closed, and I wanted to ask how you're sort of approaching the rest of that proceeding. In the past, we've seen things like just kind of deep dives with a bunch of interesting meetings on set-top and net neutrality. I don't know if we'll see something like that here. Are there particular issues that are driving your thinking, or sort of where is your head on that proceeding? Obviously a controversial one, but has flown somewhat below the radar with all the other stuff.
Thanks, Alex. Well, I think there are a couple of things there. First, you know, we had what? We had 8 weeks for comments, more than five, almost 6 weeks for reply comments. And there is this perception, I think, or misperception for some, that you get to the end of the reply comments and suddenly you fall off the edge of the earth. And as you all know better than anybody, the ongoing input and receipt of information for the record continues. We will be doing multiple ex partes. They will obviously all be disclosed in various ex parte filings. You know, I think the basic thing here, Alex, is that, you know, in some recent polls, 9 out of 10 Americans have said they've got concerns about their privacy, and they'd like to have some control over their privacy. And so what we're trying to do is to move forward and to provide the equivalent in broadband to what we have for decades been providing in narrowband.
Just to be clear, when you say we will do multiple ex partes, does that mean you've got some slate of meetings planned like you've had in the past, or just like
we're constant? I mean, there are people, okay. People ask us. People ask us to come in. We ask people to come in.
Okay.
David.
Hello. excuse me. Hello, Chairman. David Hatch, Policy and Regulatory Report. The latest version of the Democratic Party platform recommends stronger antitrust enforcement by the DOJ, FTC, and other agencies that have merger reviews under their jurisdiction. Is there more that the FCC can and should be doing in terms of scrutinizing deals?
Golly, I'm happy to stand on the record that we've had here of working with the Justice Department on merger review.
Second, David, from The Hill. I want to ask you about my favorite Capitol Hill soap opera, which is that over the past couple of months, you, in response to questions from Congress, have been really reticent to say, I'm going to leave. And you almost always say something like it's 10 months out, it's 9 months out, now is not an appropriate time for me to say something. So I'm wondering, how many months out is an appropriate time for you to say something. And if that brings us to after November 8th, is there an outcome to the presidential election that might cause you to buck tradition and stay on?
So let me parse that in a couple of parts, David. First of all, I hope Commissioner Rosenworcel gets confirmed. You know, Senator Reid has been very explicit in terms of the deal that he thought he had cut with the majority insofar as their agreement to confirm her when she worked her way through the paperwork process and the nomination was finally sent up. Commissioner Rosenworcel is an important part of this body as you saw today and as that I see every day, and she deserves to be confirmed and not held up by this random issue. I intend to work with the new administration on how do you have an appropriate next step at this agency. And that's how that kind of question will get resolved.
So you will not make a decision on what your next step is until after November 8th?
This is the responsible thing here. Is to say, you know, there is a new administration coming in, and how do you work with them to facilitate a logical transition?
If asked to stay, would you?
I haven't been.
Okay, I hear a lot about the importance of infrastructure for 5G. I think Commissioner Rosenworcel talked about it in her statement today. Uh-huh. What will the commission be doing, I don't know if this year, or do you have a timeline for infrastructure order?
Yeah, thanks, Mark. Good question. There are multiple things. As you heard, some of the things that Commissioner Rosenworcel talked about, what we have done, and as you heard me publicly say to John Wilkins, he has an agenda to deal with these kinds of issues. We obviously, there are two core issues. One is the ability to site these the new antennas, which will be multiples more than we're used to seeing and will be very different in terms of power and reach, et cetera. And the second is how do you connect them? The first one is a work in progress, and the second is one that is underway right now with our BDS proposal, broadband data services, because you just simply have to have access to and reasonable rates for the connectivity of an exploding number of base stations. You can't, you know, the new wired world moves with wires and moves with backhaul connectivity. And our BDS proceeding is dealing with that issue.
Tom, with the NCT study showing wireless causes cancer subthermally, how can you proceed with more wireless expansion with our 60 standards only recognizing thermal effects, ignoring thousands of studies showing cancerous effects, neurological effects, reproductive harm?
Lydia, do you have a question?
I do have a question, Mr.
Okay,
Chairman.
I'll answer your question, Lydia.
Lydia Bayoud, Bloomberg BNA. Mr. Chairman, in your blog post, you mentioned that Congress has the ability to expand the scope of the retrans consent regime.
Right.
Is that something that you'd like to see them do in a COMACT update? And if so, what do you think should be changed?
That's a decision they can make. I mean, this whole issue of retrans is something where we've been operating under the structures that were established, you know, by the Congress and given to us. And it's their decision to make as to whether they want to do something about that.
Kyle Daly, Bloomberg BNA.
I'm just 1-2 punch.
Hey, we got our distant cousin Todd over there to seal it up.
So is there exactly distant, and he's sitting at that end of the table. Okay. Right. Yes.
All right. So I'm just wondering, like, some of the big items that are still pending, and I'm thinking especially about set-top boxes and broadband privacy. Obviously, you've gotten a lot of pushback from Congress on those. There's even the threat of possibly having implementation blocked through appropriations. So realistically, what do you think are the chances of getting those through by January, let's say?
So, I mean, I'm glad you asked that question, because I think that there is a misconception as to how the administrative process works. The administrative process is the legal equivalent of the scientific method. Okay? You put out an idea. Somebody says, oh no, this is where you're wrong on this idea. You adjust this idea. People say, hey, let me tell you about that. And it's a back and forth kind of process. And the fact that Congress has been so involved to express various points is a very powerful proof that this scientific method called the administrative process is in fact working. And so we will continue down that process, because this is a point counterpoint. How do we make things better as a result? You know, what's the old expression that the hotter the fire, the stronger the steel? I mean, we want to come out with something that is strong steel. And this is a very healthy and positive process that ought to be viewed as that, not viewed as this is the heat is good. It is not pouring water on things.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, we have the bureaus for some questions now. Are there questions on the 5G item? Yes. Okay, wireless and OET. Okay, Lynn, go ahead.
Are the aggregation limits the same as those that were outlined in the fact sheet released when the item was circulated? I'm sorry, you couldn't hear me?
John, come forward.
Should I repeat it? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Are the aggregation limits that are adopted the same as were in the fact sheet that was released when the item was circulated, or was there changes during the last 3 weeks in the negotiation process?
With respect to the, I mean the
spectrum, the mobile spectrum.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about this. I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about the satellite receiver issue. No. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Sorry. Simple answer to a simple question. Sorry.
Any others?
Yeah.
Mr. Wilkins, can you lay out what exactly the process is going to be for, speaking of satellite aggregate interference, what the process is going to be for monitoring and looking at that issue down the road?
So as the chairman's statement said, a couple of the commissioners said, I think that we're just going to remain very open to ongoing input from industry, you know, from satellite, from terrestrial on the issue, and I think we just want to learn more as it develops. I think, you know, the reality is we are a long way from terrestrial deployment in these bands, like in the real world. And I think that really is the fundamental question. The chairman referenced the two models, lots of theoretical analysis. I think the real world question of how this is going to play out, you know, there's still time to go, and I think we're just going to remain very open to input, you know, from actual data about what it's looking like. And
so you envision this working as a system where, you know, if I'm satellite operator X, I come to you and say, by the way, this is a problem we're having, and that might trigger then further investigation or something
sure.
of that nature.
I think we always, yeah, I think the expert staff is always open to that kind of input, and especially something like this that's been flagged so clearly by the commission itself. So.
Thank you. Can we have a question?
Are you with the press?
Public? No, but we are the public and represent consumer groups who got affected by this.
This is for media, I'm sorry.
But what about the public who wants to ask a question? Are we going to let us ask our question? I mean,
yo, wireless anti-vaxxer, I represent consumer groups too, and you should shut it.
So we represent
wireless is causing cancer and neurological effects, and no one's looking at that. No one's looking at non-thermal effects.
So this is press conference, so this is just press questions. I'm sorry, ma'am.
The chairman said it's a meaningful dialogue.
She's not press.
No. And
you're not
so
press.
You're not having dialogue with people who are pregnant.
Okay, thank you. Lynn?
I'm sorry. Are there any other major changes compared to what was released in the fact sheet between that and what you've actually presented today?
Not major. I mean, there were some real adjustments in several of the areas, but
No real significant areas, and we will be working to put out an updated fact sheet this afternoon.
So the text itself won't be out today?
We're hoping to. Okay. You know, that depends on a variety of factors, but we are also hoping to put out an updated fact sheet.
Thank you so much.
Okay, anything further on this item? Okay, thanks. Are there questions on the tech transitions item? Okay, yes. So, Warlin?
Could you sort of refresh my memory and elucidate on the differences between the old, or I shouldn't say old because it still exists, but the still existing five-factor method for these 214s and this new voluntary approach? Is it just a difference in timing of whether it's automatically granted and why you think this new method is going to be more streamlined and a faster process?
Right, so this method is for a voluntary option with respect to technology transitions involving voice service, so moving away from a TDM voice service, and it gives specific objective criteria to obtain streamlined treatment. If you were to not, in that context, if it were a voice technology transition and you were to simply file not following that objective criteria, you would be evaluated under the traditional five-factor test, but outside of streamlining. So without a set time frame for expected action. Is that fair, everyone? Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lynn.
Anything further on this?
Oh, and will that be out today in any kind of hopeful scenario of the world?
We move to get it out as quickly as possible. It's hard to tell right now whether it would be exactly what time frame, but as quickly as possible. We'll see.
Thank you, Matt.
Okay, thanks.
Commissioners Pye and O'Reilly are here.
Hello, hello.
Hey, David, do you have a question?
Sure. Oh, yeah, no. We'll get out of order here. You're going to ruin everything.
Commissioner Pye, I seem to recall that you've been very critical of the FCC's approach to merger reviews and its application of the public interest standard. Does this language in the Democratic Party platform calling for stricter antitrust enforcement, not just by the DOJ and FTC, but other agencies that have jurisdiction over mergers, does that worry you? Would that essentially send a green light to the FCC that they could take even more actions under the public interest standard?
Well, I haven't seen the language you're talking about, but in any case, I don't think this is the appropriate time and place to have a political discussion, so I can't really comment.
Commissioner O'Reilly?
Well, I think as I mentioned or indicated to you 2 days ago, I've been kind of busy in the last couple of days, so I haven't read it myself. So I have no real comment until I get a chance to digest it. And I'm not sure. As I said, platforms are one mechanism for a party to outline its views, and there are many others as well. So we'll just sort of see how everything comes together.
I'd like to invite you to engage in a political discussion. A couple days ago, the House Energy and Commerce Democrats released a report, conveniently timed to coincide with the beginning of your testimony before the committee, basically saying that, that your allegations about potential abuse in the Lifeline system were baseless. And I'm wondering, have you digested that report, and what do you think about it?
Thanks for the question. I'm glad you asked. So at the hearing, I was glad to see congressmen and commissioners from both sides of the aisle express an interest in eliminating the waste, fraud, and abuse in the Lifeline system. We have to ensure, I think, on a bipartisan basis, that every dollar spent through the Universal Service Fund, including through the Lifeline program, is a dollar spent wisely. Now, the commission knows that there continues to be waste, fraud, and abuse in the Lifeline program. And we saw it in the Total Call Mobile case. And we know that Total Call Mobile wasn't alone. As I pointed out, its sales agents worked side by side with the sales agents from other wireless resellers. They also testified that they learned how to exploit some of the loopholes in the program from sales agents and supervisors who worked at various points for other Lifeline resellers. So my current investigation stems from the revelations from that case. As I said at the hearing, my investigation is ongoing, but it is already apparent that the Lifeline program, and especially the National Lifeline Accountability Database, or NLAD, has at least five different kinds of weaknesses or loopholes that unscrupulous wireless resellers can exploit to siphon money from the Universal Service Fund. And I'll spend a couple of minutes outlining them, that's all right, because I think it's important. First, USAC has reported that at least 16 other major Lifeline wireless resellers have used similar tactics as Total Call Mobile. Between October 2014 and May of 2015, USAC discovered 213,283 actual duplicates among these wireless resellers. Second, USAC has explained that the NLAD does not prevent wireless resellers from requesting and receiving federal subsidies for phantom subscribers, that is, subscribers who are not enrolled in the NLAD. And in a 16-state sample, my office has found that wireless resellers exploited this particular loophole 460,032 times. Third, Total Call Mobile was not the only carrier to exploit the old third-party independent verification, or TPIV, override process. Seven others used the old TPIV override process for more than 90% of its customers between October 2014 and February 2015. And while the new TPIV override process is better, a major loophole still remains, which is that the USAC staff doesn't review any supporting documentation before authorizing a TPIV override. And that means that unscrupulous wireless resellers can still override that safeguard, even for non-qualifying subscribers. The fourth is that the address override process is just like the old TPIV process. Although carriers are supposed to collect documentation, unscrupulous wireless resellers know that overrides are automatically granted without any USAC oversight. And the potential problem here is large. Wireless resellers have enrolled almost 500,000 subscribers through this process, the address override process, since October of 2015. Fifth and finally, the Independent Economic Household, or IEH, override process is also just like the old TPIV process. Although carriers are supposed to collect certifications, unscrupulous wireless resellers know that those overrides are automatically granted without any USAC oversight. And here, too, the potential problem is large. Wireless resellers have enrolled more than 4.2 million subscribers through this IEH override process since October of 2014. Now, there are no doubt legitimate uses of these override processes, but when nearly half of Lifeline subscribers are enrolled through an override, it is a sign that something is up. When USAC discovers hundreds of thousands of actual duplicates, it shows that there's a real problem. When resellers can claim support for phantom subscribers hundreds of thousands of times, it suggests that there's a major design flaw. And so, and when Total Call Mobile sales agents say that they exploited these loopholes hand in hand with other companies, it seems to me it's a sign that we need to keep investigating. And so I welcome the recent staff report of the House Energy and Commerce Democrats on the Lifeline program, which addressed one of the five loopholes I mentioned before. As that report states, there may be, and I quote, some level of abuse of the IEH worksheets, requiring new processes for monitoring use and the prosecution of unscrupulous wireless resellers. And I agree that, and once again I quote, the FCC should consider possible revisions to program safeguards, unquote. And that is exactly why I'm working with USAC, with the Inspector General, with the Enforcement Bureau, and why I'm reaching out to four states that don't participate in the NLAD for their support and assistance. It's clear, I think, to everybody that there are problems in the system and that those problems are caused by unscrupulous carriers like Total Call Mobile, not eligible consumers. And so we have to remember the bottom line here, that every dollar that is wasted or fraudulently spent through the Lifeline program is by definition one less dollar that goes to a deserving low-income consumer. And so I look forward to seeing what improvements can be made to the system as we continue this investigation.
Quoted them a couple times, but they also said, and now I'm quoting, that a key assumption underlying this allegation, we're talking about the fact that close to $500 million had gone towards fraudulent enrollments, that nearly everyone who used this mechanism enrolled fraudulently is wrong. So what do you think of that charge, that you vastly overestimated the number of and I believe you call them apparent duplicates, and that means that you're monetary estimation is wrong.
This is precisely the reason why we need to continue the investigation. I'm not going to prejudge what the result is before we've had a chance to gather all the facts. That is the reason why I'm in continuous dialogue with USAC and with our Enforcement Bureau and Inspector General's office.
But you came to a conclusion that you presented to a lot of us that it was close to $500 million. Are you just saying that that was preliminary, that was sort of just an estimate, that we shouldn't take that as fact?
No, what I said then was, as a result of that one category of overrides, we had seen a total of 4.2 million subscribers that had cost, for that time period, up to $476 million. And that is something that suggests that we need further investigation to understand where the facts lead. And as I said, I'm not going to prejudge the investigation. That's precisely the reason why, on a bipartisan basis and in cooperation with Congress, USAC, and others, we need to get to the bottom of this problem.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Commissioner O'Reilly, are you still considering how to vote on the Global Start order, and can you share any details of your thinking about what it is you're thinking about as you consider the order?
I can say I have not voted on that item. I'm continuing to meet with talk with interested parties and understand all of the positions. You can see that from my ex partes that have been filed, and as soon as I come to conclusion, we'll see where it goes.
David. Or two questions. First, do either one of you have a comment on the chairman's blog post today about saying no new rules are needed for retransmission disputes?
Well, I haven't read the blog post. As I understand, it came out during the meeting, so.
I just saw it. I only had a chance to review it. I want to digest it a little further.
Okay. And then do you anticipate, the vote is not completed yet on the quadrennial review, but sounds like three commissioners have voted preliminarily to approve, but do you see any changes in this before it gets finalized? I mean, is there any significant talk about?
I would not expect any major changes that will once and for all update the FCC's rule to reflect the world we are in 2016.
I think the chairman indicated he was some offices haven't voted. I have not voted. I can say that for myself. But I think the point was made by him that haven't articulated their views. But you can see my blog post, I think it's over a month ago, that outlines all my views on this subject matter. I think it's hard to square my views with where the commission seems to be going. And I'm not exceptionally optimistic that can be achieved. But hope remains eternal.
Lydia Bayoud, Bloomberg BNA. Commissioner Pai, some of your previous statements regarding your Lifeline investigation made it seem like some of those overrides and the other aspects of potential fraud that you're looking into were indeed fraudulent, but it seems as a result of this Democratic congressional report and your other statements that these are instances of potential fraud. What steps are you taking now and going forward with your investigation to make sure that you're not counting instances in which there may be some question, but they are, in fact, appropriate Lifeline subscribers or enrollments?
Well, this is part of the reason why we have an ongoing dialogue with USAC. In fact, I believe USAC is due today to supply some further responses to me. In addition, some of the facts they've already supplied, for example, with respect to phantom subscribers, that is, a Lifeline reseller getting a subsidy for somebody who, according to the National Lifeline Accountability Database, does not exist, or with respect to duplicate resellers, that is the hundreds of thousands of people who are already getting a Lifeline subsidy and for whom a Lifeline reseller is getting an additional subsidy. Those are serious problems that I think everyone would agree we need to take a serious look at.
Will you be sharing that data?
As to the extent that I can do so without jeopardizing any potential investigation, I'll be certainly happy to work with any interested parties to share some of my findings.
Kyle Daly, also Bloomberg BNA, and I'm also talking about a different Lifeline-centric investigation. Just wondering, I know that the IG's office has is looking into this, but we're still sort of trying to parse what exactly happened on March 31st. Is there any insight that either of you can give us on what happened with that Lifeline item and you know, with respect to who may have spoken to press and when, that sort of thing?
Since there's an ongoing Inspector General investigation, I'm not going to comment, but you can see what I've said in the past about what happened on March 31st, and I stand by every word I've said.
I think it's probably best if I don't comment given the investigation. You know how my thoughts about that item has already been talked about.
Alex?
I wanted to ask a privacy-related question. I think a somewhat under-the-radar component of that debate has been that tech groups who represent, obviously, websites that are not covered by the chairman's proposal have started to, if not flat-out oppose the proposal, expressed, you know, pretty serious concern about it. And one of the reasons that they've suggested or that they've used to forward that stance is that even though the chairman's proposal doesn't cover them, you know, they think that it could prompt something like that in the future, either from a future FCC or another agency or something on the Hill. And I'm just wondering if that is a concern for you guys as well.
Two parts. One, I have said many, many months ago that I believe it's just a matter of time before the commission gets into edge providers and regulates them in different capacity. Two, if you, you know, follow the arguments of the advocacy groups on this space, their goal, and they've said this publicly, is to enact privacy rules for broadband providers here, carry that over to the FTC, impose that, not even though not identical, because they wouldn't want to have, you know, similar rules. They want some unique rules for edge providers so we can have bifurcated structure, but they want to take the precedent here and take that to the FTC. Third, I would say if you look at the Commission's actions on net neutrality, if you look at the arguments of the virtuous cycle, that it's just a matter of time before a commission, it may not be this commission, but I think it's important to point out that the chairman always says we don't regulate apps, but we actually have in some instances with 911, privacy, you know, location, we have done some activity on apps. So it's just a matter of time, in my opinion, before the commission goes in that direction, given what the breadth of the decision in the court of the action of this commission.
I would agree with everything Commissioner O'Reilly has said, and I would just add two quick observations. First, if you listen carefully to what the chairman said on Tuesday, his answer in response to a question about that was that we do not intend to regulate edge providers. And I think we all know, given the agency's recent regulatory trajectory, that intentions often give way to political considerations. Secondly, if you look at some of the testimony that was adduced before the Senate Commerce Committee recently, and in particular, the Obama administration's first FTC chair, John Leibowitz, and ITI's Dean Garfield, they presented a very compelling case for having a single set of privacy regulations that applied to everybody. And I think the danger, as Commissioner O'Reilly pointed out, when the FCC imposes disparate regulations on ISPs is that either at the FCC or at the FTC, we would eventually see edge providers swept into this regulatory morass. And I don't think that's something that would benefit consumers, ultimately, not in addition to the edge providers.